Welcome to this HP Expert One presentation. In this video, we're discussing VLANs, or Virtual Local Area Networks. Virtualization is a big topic these days, with companies such as VMware virtualizing servers. But here we're looking at the virtualization of our infrastructure. VLANs have been around for many years, and in a similar way to the virtualization of servers, here we're taking one physical switch and configuring the switch to act as multiple virtual switches. This is not full virtualization. We are simply virtualizing the local area networks on a switch. In other words, making one physical switch act as multiple layer 2 virtual switches. In this video, we're going to discuss the theory of VLANs. You cannot discuss VLANs without discussing trunking protocols or tag protocols such as 802.1q. Now, terminology can easily trip you up, so I'm going to explain the differences between Comware and Provision VLAN terminology. On HP switches running the Comware operating system, you would configure trunk ports and access ports. On HP switches running the Provision operating system, however, you configure tagged and untagged ports. So I'm going to spend a bit of time explaining the differences between these terms, as they can cause a lot of confusion. Let's get started. Now, it's important that a network be designed correctly. In an incorrectly or poorly designed network, multiple issues can occur. In this topology, we have a single switch and a single hub with multiple devices connected to the switch and hub. If device A sent a broadcast, that broadcast would be received by all devices in the topology because this is a single broadcast domain. A layer 2 switch will flood broadcasts out of all ports except the port on which it was received. A hub will do the same thing. So every device in the topology will receive that broadcast, and additionally will need to process that broadcast. Now, that may not be a problem. However, if the host started jabbering, in other words, the network card sent broadcast after broadcast after broadcast, that would cause issues on your network. Firstly, you have these flooding of broadcasts everywhere, consuming bandwidth. Every device on the network needs to process that broadcast, which slows the CPU down, and in the worst cases, reduces throughput and processing power dramatically. This issue could exponentially increase as the number of hosts on the network increases and more devices are affected by those broadcasts. It is good practice to limit or contain broadcasts within a network. In IP version 6, as an example, no broadcasts are supported. Only unicasts, multicasts, and something called anycasts. Broadcasts have been removed from IP version 6. Now, continuing with the same example, this is a switch, so each port on this switch is a separate collision domain. There are four collision domains in this topology. A hub acts as a single collision domain. So in total, we have four collision domains. A collision on any switch port is contained to that switch port. So if there's a collision on this hub, that collision is contained to port 04 on the switch. It doesn't affect other ports. However, broadcasts are flooded out of every port on the switch. So with VLANs, we can contain the broadcasts on layer 2 switches. Here's another example. In this example, if this core or central switch went down, devices would not be able to communicate with one another. So if the core switch went offline, this PC would not be able to communicate with this PC. In networks, it's good practice to implement redundancy. So you want to try and avoid a single point of failure, which you have with this design. So what is a VLAN, or Virtual Local Area Network? A VLAN is essentially a single broadcast domain, or logical subnet, or logical network. You could say that it's a group of hosts with a common set of requirements attached to the same broadcast domain, and this is regardless of where they're physically located. It's possible with VLANs to group multiple devices together logically rather than physically, and then to span a subnet or VLAN across multiple physical switches. It is possible to design your VLANs to allow a group of devices or hosts to be segmented logically by a department or project team or function or type of application, once again without regard to the physical location of those devices. What are some of the advantages of VLANs? The first one is segmentation. You can segment or separate users based on function. For instance, the sales department could be put into a specific VLAN and the accountancy department put into a different VLAN. You are segmenting users based on function or department. It's possible to move a user from one VLAN to another without changing physical cabling. And probably the biggest reason why people implement VLANs is to provide security. You can put users into separate VLANs, which will then force them to traverse a layer 3 device such as a router when sending traffic from one VLAN to another, and then you can implement access control lists or ACLs to control which users have access to which VLANs. So in other words, a user in VLAN 10 may be restricted from communicating with a user in VLAN 20 via the use of an ACL or access list. VLANs can also be used to provide quality of service, or QoS, where IP phones are put into a voice VLAN and PCs are put into a data VLAN, and then traffic from voice is prioritized over data traffic. So there are multiple reasons to implement VLANs in modern day networks. The most common reason is security, but please be aware that there are multiple advantages to VLANs. Segmentation also allows us to separate broadcast traffic. In other words, VLANs contain broadcast traffic. Broadcast traffic sent on VLAN 10 will not traverse to VLAN 20, and that has great advantages, allowing you to improve the efficiency and performance of your network. A lot of networks are designed as a single flat layer 2 network. In other words, all devices are within the same VLAN, typically VLAN 1, which is the default VLAN on HP switches. That means that all of these devices are within the same subnet. Let's say 172.16.0.0/16. That subnet supports 65,000 hosts. So some companies may have 2,000 devices within the same VLAN. That causes a lot of issues. Broadcast traffic from one device is seen by all devices in the topology. Now, that may not be a problem in a small network, but when you've got a large number of devices in the same subnet, that can seriously degrade the performance of your network. Broadcast traffic causes issues on networks and should be contained. So a flat network without VLANs and many devices will have poor throughput when compared to a device segmented with VLANs. Something that often confuses network engineers when they first learn about VLANs is the difference between the physical topology and the logical topology. You need to change your paradigm and no longer think and look at the physical topology of the network, but rather envision what the logical topology looks like. The logical topology is very different to the physical topology as soon as VLANs are implemented. Don't make the mistake of looking at the physical topology when trying to troubleshoot VLANs. As soon as VLANs are implemented, you need to look at the logical topology when troubleshooting. Don't just look at the physical topology. Have a look at the effect of the VLANs on the logical topology and how that affects data transmission within your network. Now, here's a simple topology to demonstrate the difference between the physical topology and the logical topology of a network. In this slide, we're looking at the physical topology. We have a single switch, four PCs, A, B, C, and D. A is connected to port 1, B to 2, C to 3, and D to 4. So a very simple physical topology. However, when we logically put interfaces into different VLANs, the topology will change. So in this topology, let's say we've put A and D into the red VLAN and C and B into the green VLAN. How will that change the topology? Now, before showing you the difference, just be aware that you type commands on the interfaces of switches to move them from the default VLAN of 1 into another VLAN. VLANs are configured via numbers, but for simplicity, we tend to explain them using colors. So in this example, let's assume once again that we've got the red VLAN and the green VLAN. A and D have been put into the red VLAN by typing commands on port 1 and port 4. C and B are put into the green VLAN by typing commands on port 2 and port 3. It's important to realize that the PCs are oblivious to the fact that they've been moved from one VLAN to another. You as an administrator, configure the switch and change the settings on individual ports, moving them from one VLAN to another. No configuration needs to be done on the PCs. They are unaware of the fact that they've moved from one VLAN to another. So once again, this is our physical topology, one switch, four PCs. However, the logical topology is very different to the physical topology. PC A and PC D are in the red VLAN. PC C, PC B are in the green VLAN. They are logically separated at layer 2. They are logically connected to separate switches or separate LANs. We have virtualized our LAN infrastructure and created two separate logical area networks. These networks cannot communicate with each other from a layer 2 point of view. VLANs are implemented at layer 2 of the OSI model, and the only way that one VLAN can communicate with another VLAN is via a layer 3 device, such as a router. So there's no communication between these two VLANs. The red VLAN devices cannot communicate with the green VLAN and vice versa. Each VLAN is a separate logical subnet or separate broadcast domain. So let's have a look at what happens when a broadcast is sent in a topology like this. In a few minutes, I'm going to show you how to enable communication between VLANs. But for now, let's assume that we have only one layer 2 switch. So a single layer 2 switch. We have four devices, A and D on the red VLAN, B and C on the green VLAN. What happens if A sends a broadcast? Now in this topology, rather than using 48-bit MAC addresses, I'm just going to represent the devices with MAC addresses A, B, C, and D. So let's assume that those values are the MAC addresses of these devices. That will allow us to keep things simple rather than writing out 48-bit MAC addresses. Now, a broadcast has a MAC address of 8 Fs at layer 2. And at layer 3, 255, 255, 255, 255. So let's assume that A sends a frame to the switch with a destination MAC address of Fs. In other words, a broadcast. What will the switch do with that traffic? Will it forward it out of all ports, or will it only go to certain devices? Now, if we hadn't put our devices into separate VLANs, they would by default be in VLAN 1. That means that when a broadcast is received by the switch, which in this case is a layer 2 switch, will firstly make a note of where A is. So in its MAC address table, it will make a note that A is on port 01. It will then flood the MAC address out of all ports, except the port on which it was received. So C, D and B would receive that broadcast. However, in this example, A is in the red VLAN, so is D, but C and B are in the green VLAN. So the first thing the switch will do is it'll make a note in its MAC address table saying that A is on port 01. Now, interface numbers will vary depending on the switch that you work on. On a switch running the ProCurve operating system, the port numbers may be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so forth, and so on. Or on a modular switch running the ProCurve operating system, it may be A1, A2, A3, A4. And then on a switch running the COMware operating system, it may be 101, 102, 103, 104. In this example, I'm just going to keep the interface numbers simple by referring to them as 01, 02, 03, and 04. So in this case, the MAC address table is updated to state that A is on port 01. The switch knows that because it received a frame with a source address of A on that port. So in the actual frame, we would see a destination address of Fs. So there would be 8 Fs there and a source address of A. The switch then updates its MAC address table to show that A is on port 01. What happens with the broadcast? Is it flooded out of all ports? Now, when that frame arrives on the port, not only is the MAC address table updated, but the frame is also internally marked. So we've got a frame with a destination address of F's, source address of A. Internally, it's marked as the red VLAN. So there's an internal marking within the switch to denote that this frame arrived on a red port. Now the configuration of these ports is done manually. The PC is unaware, once again, that it's in a VLAN. At this point here, it's a standard Ethernet frame. There is no marking, no tagging. It's just a pure Ethernet frame. The switch, however, is marking the frame internally as a red VLAN frame. Now, depending on the switch architecture, what typically happens is internally in the switch, the frame is copied to all ports. So if the backplane is a bus, which in a lot of cases it is, the frame will be copied to each individual port of the switch. Please refer to hp.com/networking if you want to get details of the backplanes of switches. We're not going to cover that here. So we're going to assume that the backplane is a bus and the frame is copied to every port. Now that would happen whether it was a broadcast, multicast, or unicast. In this case, it's a broadcast frame, so that frame needs to go to every port on the switch. And in this case, the frame is copied to every port, but it's not flushed. In a moment, I'm going to show you what happens with a unicast frame, where the frame is initially sent to every port, but then is flushed from certain ports. But in this example, the broadcast is received on port 1 and is sent to every port. Is the frame sent out of all ports on the switch? Now the frame, once again, has a destination address of F's, source address of A, but it's been tagged with the red VLAN internally. So on this interface here, the switch makes a decision. It says this port belongs to the green VLAN, but you are a red VLAN frame, so it drops the frame. The frame is not sent out of that port. The same thing happens on this port. This is a green VLAN port. The frame is a red frame, so the frame is dropped. It's not forwarded out of that port. However, this is a red VLAN interface, and this is a red frame, so the frame is forwarded out of the port. However, before transmission, the switch will remove the tag. So at this point over here, it's sent as a standard Ethernet frame with the destination address of F's, in other words, broadcast, and source address of A. Now, for simplicity, I'm not writing out the full 8 F's, but just note that this is a broadcast frame with 8 F's at layer 2. So the tag is removed. It goes as a standard Ethernet frame to D. So what's the result of VLANs? A broadcast frame sent from A is only received by other devices in that VLAN. PCB and PCC do not receive the broadcast because they are in a separate VLAN. Physically, the topology looks as follows. But once again, logically, it looks like this. Traffic from A is only received by D. C and B do not receive that traffic. Even if A sends a broadcast, only D receives the broadcast. B and C do not see the broadcast. The layer 2 switch is logically segmented into two separate LANs. Now, what would happen if A sent a unicast frame to C? A once again is in the red VLAN and C is in the green VLAN. Now, A wouldn't normally be able to learn the MAC address of C. So we are assuming here that A has somehow learned the MAC address of C and is sending a frame directly to C. So you may be guessing the MAC address or using a hacking tool to try and access a machine in a different VLAN. The frame will be sent as a standard Ethernet frame from A to the switch. Once again, the devices are unaware of VLANs, so they send standard Ethernet frames. Now, switches once again will update their MAC address table based on information received from incoming frames. So let's assume that at this point, the switch has A in its MAC address table on port 01 and C in its MAC address table on port 03. So both those MAC addresses are in the MAC address table of the switch, and thus the switch knows that it needs to send the traffic out of this port to get to that PC. However, when the frame arrives on the port, the frame is tagged as red. So destination address is C, source address is A. The frame is internally tagged as red by the switch. Based on the switch architecture, what's typically going to happen is that frame is going to be sent to every port on the switch. So it's actually copied to every port. It will then be flushed based on the information in the MAC address table. So the frame here is flushed, the frame here is flushed, but the frame needs to be sent out of that port based on the MAC address table. Will the frame be permitted out of that port? And the answer is no. This port is in the green VLAN. The frame is a red VLAN frame. So the frame is dropped. Even if A somehow learnt the MAC address of C and tried to send traffic to that device, the frames would not be permitted. Once again, this is our physical topology. A and C are in different VLANs, but logically, the network looks as follows. A is separated from C. There is no way that they can communicate at layer 2. The VLANs enforce separation between these two devices. Now, terminology can cause a lot of confusion, and this is typical when it comes to tag, untag, trunk, or access ports. This is dependent on your background. Do you come from a 3COM or H3C background? Do you come from a ProCurve background? Or have you worked on another vendor? It's very easy to misunderstand the terminology. So when configuring these ports and putting them into individual VLANs, they would be known as access ports or untagged ports. Now, on HP switches, you may encounter two operating systems. Either the provision operating system, which comes originally from the ProCurve devices, or the Comware operating system, which comes originally from the H3C devices. Either the provision operating system, which was run previously on ProCurve devices, and the Comware operating system, which was run previously on H3C devices. So switches that you encounter may be running one of these operating systems. When running the provision operating system, these ports are known as untagged ports. When running the Comware operating system, they are known as access ports. Now, an access port or untagged port belongs to a single VLAN. In other words, there is one untagged VLAN configured on that port. There are no tagged frames. It's standard Ethernet. We're going to discuss in a moment tagged or trunk ports, but just be aware that there are no special frames sent on untagged or access ports. It's just standard Ethernet. So that port belongs to one untagged VLAN and the device is said to be in that VLAN. So as an example, device A is in the red VLAN, device D is in the red VLAN. However, when you configure VLANs, you configure them as numbers. VLAN 1 is the default VLAN that all devices are in. So when a switch is shipped by HP, all ports are untagged in VLAN 1. If you want to move devices from one VLAN to another, you would do the following. So on a device running the Provision operating system, you would type the command enable, configure, or configure terminal. You would specify the VLAN, so in this case VLAN 2, and then you would configure a port in that VLAN. Now on modular switches, you would use commands such as untag A1. On a fixed port switch, you would use a command such as untag 1. This is the interface number. So you select the VLAN and then associate ports with that VLAN. On COMWARE devices, it works slightly differently. So on COMWARE, you type system view, specify the VLAN, and then you select the interface and associate the interface to the VLAN. COMWARE also allows you to associate ports within the VLAN, so similar to Provision, but this is the most typical example. Create the VLAN, specify the port, and then associate the port to the VLAN. So that was a very simple example where we had one switch with the PCs configured in different VLANs. Now let's look at a slightly more complicated topology. In this topology, we have two switches, switch 1 and switch 2. Switch 1 has A configured in the red VLAN, B in the green VLAN, and switch 2 has C configured in the green VLAN and D in the red VLAN. This is the physical topology of the network. The switches are also connected to one another. This is the physical topology of our network. So each switch has two PCs in different VLANs, and the switches are connected to each other. Now the link between the switches is configured differently. This link or port would typically be configured as an 802.1q trunk or tagged port. And once again, this has got to do with terminology. Essentially, switch 1 needs to indicate to switch 2 which VLAN the traffic originated from. And by the same token, switch 2 needs to indicate to switch 1 which VLAN traffic originated from when it receives traffic from its PCs. So for example, if A were sending traffic to D, it would send the traffic as an untagged frame on port 01. There's no indication of VLAN, but that information needs to be sent from switch 1 to switch 2. So the switches need a mechanism to indicate the VLAN, and that's what 802.1q does. So let's firstly look at the terminology. I want to show you an 802.1q frame, and then we'll come back to this example and look at how the frames traverse. So ports connecting switches using 802.1q are known on HP switches running the Provision operating system as tag ports. On HP switches running the COMWARE operating system, they're known as trunk ports. Now, a trunk port or tag port consists of a single untagged VLAN. I'm going to explain this in more detail in a moment, but just to ensure that everyone understands the terminology, the untagged VLAN on a trunk or tagged port is known as the native VLAN in Cisco. It's known as the PVID or port VLAN identifier in COMWARE, and it's known as the untagged VLAN in Provision. So it's the same thing, native PVID or untagged VLAN. It is untagged, in other words, there's no 802.1q tag attached to the frame. It's sent as a standard Ethernet frame. But is it a tomato or is it a tomato? Is it gas or is it petrol? Is it a native VLAN, PVID, or untagged VLAN? different terms but the same thing. Trunk ports or tag ports also allow for multiple tagged VLANs. So on a trunk port or tag port, there is one untagged VLAN, known as the PVID on Comware or untagged VLAN on Provision, and there are multiple tagged VLANs. Editor 1Q can support 4,096 VLANs, but that number of VLANs isn't necessarily supported on all switches. So the number of VLANs supported on switches is device dependent, but in theory, you could have 4,096 VLANs on a trunk or tag port, one of which is going to be untagged. Now, just to add a bit more confusion, HP devices running the Provision operating system use the word trunk or trunking to imply the bonding of multiple physical links together into a single aggregated link. On devices running the Comware operating system, this is known as link aggregation or bridge aggregation. On Cisco, this is known as Ether channel. So once again, don't get confused by the terminology. When working on a device running the Provision operating system, a trunk is not the same as a trunk on a device running Comware. Trunking on Provision equals link aggregation on Comware or Ether channel on Cisco. That concludes this first video discussing VLANs. In the next video, we'll continue the discussion by looking at 802.1Q trunking or tagged ports. We'll also discuss inter-VLAN routing and a few other topics related to VLANs. For more information, please go to hp.com/go/expert1.